your favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
I am recording now. 1, 2, 3. Hey, and we're back. Welcome back to Special Presentation with Mike and Ethan, or...
Alf will not be seen tonight.
Yes, and tonight we're going back to when you would never see Alf. About,
no.
What, like 15 years before Alf?
That's right. We're going to the way, way back, the puppet times.
Yes.
The pre-puppet times. There are no puppets in this at all.
Are there? Are you sure? Some of these things look like puppets to me.
Oh my god. This was before puppet technology had been invented. This is back when all they had were like sticks and rocks to entertain themselves.
Yeah, this is like an animated version of Plato's Allegory of the Cave.
Yeah, that is exactly what it is. Because this is, let me tell you, this is beyond. So
this is tonight, a good sign.
we were gonna talk about something else, but then Ethan sent me this thing, and just from the first like minute, I was like, I think maybe this is something we should really like look at. We should really like dive into.
Yes.
this is Ethan. What is this, and where did you find this?
I have no memory now of where I found it. I think I found it because it was mentioned on Wikipedia. I think I was actually looking up other stuff that we could do for this podcast, and I saw the title, and I was like, gold!
Yeah, this is probably the greatest title since, what is it, Dr. Otto and the Gloom Bean.
Yes, Dr.
Or
Otto.
Or before, and, or I should say, until Dr. Otto and the Gloom
Bean.
Because... Well,
the best title is since Bela Lugosi meets a Brooklyn gorilla.
Yes, this is the title is it. What was it?
It's Popeye meets the man who hated laughter.
So just roll that around in your head for just a second. Just think about that for a minute.
Popeye. Who, let's not forget, is a comic strip character and counts for our purposes.
Yes. He's going to meet a man who hates to laugh. Now, I don't know about you, but I love to laugh. And I think most of us do. So
yes.
That was pretty intriguing when I heard that there was a guy who hates laughter. It's like, we got to look at this. We got to check this out.
Well, I don't know because, you know, Mike and I... have bonded a lot over our kind of latent grouch tendencies to be happy when we're sad and sad when we're happy.
And that is true, yes.
So I kind of identify with this man who hates laughter. However, I don't think Popeye ever actually meets the man who hates laughter because I think that guy was the guy who wrote the script.
Oh!
Take that, man who hated laughter!
I will say this. When I was intrigued by the idea, of the man who hates laughter. But then watching this film, I found myself sympathizing with him a lot. Because, in fact, he was absolutely correct to do what he did. So I think this is King Features, right?
Yes, King. What does King Features... Well, I guess now we know exactly what King Features does, don't we? It was all
we
here.
Do. Every single piece of garbage comic strip that King Features owned appeared in this amazingly comprehensive crossover from 1972. So, predating Cartoon All-Stars The Rescue by a good, 20 years?
Yes, and without the everyone being free because it was to help kids on drugs.
Yeah. It's like, if you know how when you watch Cartoon All-Stars Rescue and you're really excited because you got to see all your favorite cartoons together, well, get excited because you're going to see all the cartoons you hate together. that's too strong. All the cartoons that you do not care about and you have not thought about in 20 years are all together for this one.
All the cartoons that your grandpa thought were a little old and repetitive.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, yeah, because this is from 1972, and I think some of the characters...
Little King?
Yeah! The Cats and Yammer Kids?
The Cats and Yammer Kids! Where was the Yellow Kid? Come on!
Henry was in this! Oh, man.
Who even is Henry?
You don't remember... Okay, so Henry, I actually remember Henry. He was still around when we were kids, but he was basically a little bald kid who never talked... And, you know, he walked around and wacky things happened and he would react to them. He was like Lilo if Lilo was bad. Or Leo, sorry, not Lilo.
Oh, that Leo, okay.
yeah.
Oh, boy, like, Leo. Now there is a Halloween special waiting to happen.
Yeah, so you're actually, you know, when you think about it, it's too bad Leo has come out post the heyday of comic strip specials, because Leo would be pretty perfect for Halloween. But Henry is like Leo if Leo was bald and unfunny. And, but he's in this as well as who else is in it? We've got Snuffy Smith.
Snuffy Smith is there, and Sparkplug. I mean, when was the last time you saw Sparkplug in the Snuffy Smith comic? I mean, I haven't read it in years. I don't know.
I only know the Sparkplug exists because I've read those giant coffee table Smithsonian books about the history of comics.
Yeah, more specifically the history of Peanuts and how Charles Schultz got his nickname Sparky because he was a fan of Sparkplug, and which was apparently Barney Google and Sparkplug were a national phenomenon because we were really hard up for national phenomena at the time, I guess.
That's right, and I believe so. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but so originally the comic strip was Barney Google, who was like a little guy in a top hat, right?
Yeah, Barney Google, who has big round eyes, goo goo googly eyes, as the song went.
Right.
He wasn't in this.
No, he was not, because this was already post Barney Google, because Barney Google, I believe, went on vacation to like the Ozarks or something and met Snuffy Smith, who got so popular that gradually Barney Google was phased out of the comic. And I believe to this day, the comic is still called Barney Google and Snuffy Smith. So you see Barney Google's name up there really tiny.
Yeah.
But he has not appeared in like 50 years.
Yeah, the title of the strip is Barney Google and Snuffy Smith.
Yeah, Snuffy Smith, I believe, like initiated the national craze for hillbilly humor that like everyone in the 50s and 60s were just like mad about. Everyone thought it was just, you know, when everyone was like, the funniest thing in the world you could do was use a piece of rope for a belt.
Do you think it was Snuffy Smith or was it Little Abner?
Oh, that's a good point. Was Lil Abner before? I mean, I feel like they might have been concurrent.
Yeah,
they might have been.
It was just tapping into the zeitgeist, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, you know, maybe they're all copying the Beverly Hillbillies. I'm not really sure.
Yeah, do you call that? What do you call that setting? Would you call it like, I don't know, jug punk?
Yeah, actually, I like that. And that. Oh my God, yes, it's called jug punk. Now. You're going to have – okay, so when you make a proper jug punk milieu, what you have to do is do it like the Flintstones so that instead of – so their cars are all like powered by just like razorback hogs that they have running under them and, you know, and who are just turning and be like, it's a living to the camera.
And they have vending machines that dispense moonshine.
Yeah, yeah. And then they're going to like – you know, and there'll be that episode where the, you know, the, cause it's going to be about a family. It's basically about like, you know, Ma and Pa Kettle, I guess. And they're like, they're going to have their like sexy teenage daughter. Who's basically like, you know, a grown up Pebbles from Pebbles. Yeah. From the Flintstone thing. And she's going to do the one where she gets really into like listening to, I don't know, Justin Bieber on Victrola or something. And they're going to be like, oh, I hate this new music that the kids listen to. Not Justin Bieber. I don't know who the kids listen to nowadays. Demi Lovato? I don't know.
Crap. What's that? You know, I don't know, because I'm just looking back to the last Weird Al album, and I think everyone from there is already no longer relevant.
Wow, but Weird Al's still going, yep. You know?
Weird Al will outlive us all. Hey, here's a question completely unrelated mm-hmm. to our subject. Which Weird Al song do you think has most completely supplanted the song that it parodies?
You know what? That's a good question. I'm going to say Amish Paradise.
That was on my list too. I thought it was either Amish Paradise or I Lost on Jeopardy.
Oh. What is Lost on Jeopardy a parody of?
Well, the song is called Jeopardy, but the refrain is I was in Jeopardy, baby. But it is the guy who sang I Was in Jeopardy who drives the car that Weird Al gets thrown into at the end of his video.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, I guess he had a sense of humor about it then.
Yeah, it's nice when they do that. Like how, what's his name from Money for Nothing, the guy from Dire Straits said, can I play guitar on Money for Nothing Beverly Hillbillies?
That's funny.
Yeah, which meant that they had to call it Money for Nothing / Beverly Hillbillies instead of the title The Ballad of Jed Clampett, which it shows in the movie UHF. So,
oh, that's so funny, man. Oh, well. Anyway, there are a lot of hillbillies in this thing that we're talking about today, yes. Because both Snuffy Smith and his wife, whose name I forget.
His towering nun-like wife. I don't know what her name is, but...
And Sparkplug, for some reason, they own Sparkplug in this. Oh, and they do mention Jughead is in it, though I don't think he ever appears on screen. I don't think we ever see Jughead.
Which one is Jughead?
Jughead is their son.
Oh.
Jughead is their son.
Oh, the one who wears the coonskin cap?
Yes, and has the face of a 100-year-old man, even though he's supposedly a child. Because whoever draws Snuffy Smith, a name which I cannot be bothered to remember, that artist is bad. He cannot draw.
Let us not forget that all of these characters look terrible in animation. It is a universal rule of this whole... The only characters that look good at all are the original characters created for it.
Yeah, that's true. Meaning the man who hated laughter.
The titular man, Morbid Grimsby.
Yeah. That's right, because he is Professor.
Professor Macabre Morbid Grimsby. Yes.
Morbid, sorry, yes. So he looks like a Jay Ward character. He looks like he just stumbled out of Rocky and Bullwinkle. What is his plot? He is a
professor,
right?
What I wrote down here was that he is the... If you had him standing between Wario and Waluigi, it would just be like, you know, they were meant for each other. I was imagining that, and it just like, Bogus, Bunce, and Bean. One fat, one short, and one lean.
Oh, yeah. So our man, Professor Grimsley, he hates laughter, and he has a plan to stop everyone in the world from laughing.
Yeah, he hates laughter, and whenever onomatopoeic laughter appears around him, he hits it with a fly swatter.
Yes.
It seems joke is written for a comic rather than a movie, but oh well.
Yeah. Occasionally he uses one of those old-timey, like, bug spray things, you know? But yeah, he decides he's going to stop all laughter in the world, and someone has misinformed him that comics are funny, so he is going to kidnap every comic strip character and keep them on his island in the South Pacific forever so that they will not be able to make anyone laugh.
First of all, that is demonstrably untrue.
Yes.
Second of all, you missed Charlie Brown, idiot.
That's right. Who, you know, I would say is probably funnier than any of the ones he actually got.
Yes.
Because we've established he catches... Snuffy Smith, he gets the Little King, Henry. Henry, who else is on it?
Who's Quincy? Cast and Jammer Kid. I never saw him before.
I've never heard of Quincy, yeah.
Iodine? Is that a thing?
Yeah. I feel like Little Iodine she sounds more like a Harvey character, but apparently
she is. I was going to say, she should be hanging out with Little Dot and Little Lotta, but...
Yeah. High and Lois are there as well.
Yes.
So we've got them.
High and Lois and Beetle and Sarge. And we never acknowledge You know, did you know that Lois is Beetle's sister?
I've heard that, but they never bring it up in this special.
No.
I think they forgot.
Beetle and Sarge and they, Otto.
Oh, yeah. And, oh, gosh, there was someone else who was relatively well known. The Bumsteads. The Bumsteads are in there,
Blondie and Dagwood and their whole family come.
Yeah. And so I think that's... and of course Popeye.
Popeye and Olive Oil and Wimpy and Sweet Pea. Right. But does Sweet Pea ever show up on the boat? I don't remember.
I can't remember. Oh, yeah, I think he does because he points out the spinach at one point.
Oh, right. Okay. Yeah, he does. Right. But Bluto is not here. Instead, we have Brutus. Now, this is a weird thing that was going on in the 70s and 80s, where the King Features thought they didn't have the rights to the character Bluto. They thought he was created by the Fleischers. It turns out that E.C. Segar did, in fact, create Bluto. He just didn't really come up with use the name Bluto in the actual strips. So they had to make do with this substitute character called Brutus, who was basically like,
he's of Bluto. The same.
Bluto is the maritime version of Brutus. Brutus is the same guy, except he's not a sailor. He's just a sort of fat, disheveled man that is into olive oil. And
wears a turban for some reason.
Yeah, why is he wearing a turban?
I do not. Nothing about this makes any sense. This was so obviously thrown together as a cash grab, I assume, because I don't know how things worked in the 70s, but I don't know. But yeah, so Brutus is working for the professor. He's his sidekick.
Yes.
And the professor basically says, I need to catch all these characters, so I'm going to hire Popeye to pilot a ship, and then I'm going to send like notes to all these other characters telling them they've won a free cruise to trick them into coming on my ship that I will then kidnap and put on my island.
Also, this is all after we are dropped in on it in media res, because the first thing we see is all of King Features's like superhero soap opera characters having been brought to the White House to discuss the plan to rescue the comics, as they're called.
Yes.
These characters are called the comics for some reason. And
yeah. Okay. So these superheroes, we've got, it's basically Defenders of the Earth, isn't it?
Yeah. It's Defenders of the Earth, like 14 years earlier.
So we've got like, the Phantom. We've got, Mandrake the Magician. Mm-hmm.
And Lothar, who is being, again, who thankfully, like Defenders of the Earth, is not being treated as a sidekick so much as on equal terms with Mandrake.
Is Lothar, what is Lothar's thing? I only know him from Defenders of the Earth.
Well, he got his start early on with Mandrake as his kind of big, dumb, hulking sidekick who said, me save you, Mandrake, and stuff like that. But, by Defenders of the Earth, they had decided that he was kind of like an international James Bond or something like that. But
okay.
Yeah, I can handle that.
At this point, even in the 70s, they were like, maybe it's a little too problematic to just have him be.
I mean, I appreciate that on their part. And, Steve Canyon?
I have no clue who that is.
Me neither.
I've never heard this guy.
I thought it was Flash Gordon at first.
Yeah, but Flash Gordon does show up.
Yes.
So he's in this too. So it's two blonde guys who basically look the same. Steve Canyon, from his name, I just assume he's like a dime store Race Bannon from Johnny Quest.
Yeah, but I was going to say he's probably kind of got that King Solomon's Mines thing going on, but I'm not really sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a kid. I mean, who's the kid?
Oh, yeah. He must be like, I assume he must be one of their kids. Whose sidekick is he? I'm not sure.
I don't know. I mean, I'm guessing he's Steve Canyon's, because I don't remember seeing this kid he didn't come down with Flash Gordon, and I don't think Mandrake hangs out with this kid, but
Mandrake has like, I'm trying to remember from the Defenders of the Earth, he's got a little blonde kid that hangs out with them.
Yeah, but I think the kids from Defenders of the Earth were invented for Defenders of the Earth. Maybe.
Oh, okay. Never mind then. Disregard. Okay, I'm gonna assume he's like probably Steve Canyon's sidekick because yeah. they're both blondes, and I feel like in the 70s they wouldn't mix up hair colors.
I don't know. But they might give him his own Haji, but
Yeah. They'd give Haji to like a Mandrake, I feel like. That just feel, yeah. But anyway, so they are called up by the president to go rescue the comics.
Yes.
1972, the president is Richard Nixon, but yes. we never actually see him on screen. But
and they just call him the chief, which is really yeah. weird.
So just again.
And then there's this.
Oh, sorry, hello?
I'm here.
Oh, sorry, my thing froze for a second. So anyway, go on.
So, yeah, there's. Yeah, so the. So the president's, I guess, his personal assistant who looks...
I think it's Henry Kissinger.
That's what I thought, too. So Henry Kissinger, fresh from another tour of Cambodia, is telling them... is saying that, you know, without the comics, people will have nothing to laugh at except us politicians. Womp, womp.
Wah, wah, wah. Zing! If this is Henry Kissinger, this entire operation is just some big psyop. It's really just. Oh my god!
I know
this whole thing.
I know that if I wanted to MK Ultra somebody, I'd just show them this shirt a bunch. But...
This is what they showed to goats to make them faint. You know? Oh god! This whole
now
thing.
I'm just thinking of Opus and the rabbits. They're only lightly stunned.
Oh god, oh man. So
don't forget this theme song. He was the man who hated laughter.
It sounds, you know, when I heard that, it just sounds like I'm the man who murdered love from the Gilmore Girls. It's just, oh god, it's incredibly 70s.
Yeah, I wrote here that this theme song could not get more 1972 unless you plastered Ricky Ticky stickies on it.
Oh my god. You know, I also have to mention, like, the version that I watched, and I probably you as well, it still had original commercials in it.
I think they might have been part of the program because there weren't any other commercials except for two commercials for Cap'n Crunch. And then a countdown.
Yeah. And those Captain Crunch commercials, way better animated than the actual special.
That is so embarrassing.
Yeah.
Especially considering it was probably much of the same talent working on them.
Yeah. I mean, look, Jean-Claude Lafoot, the pirate, looks almost exactly like the man who hated laughter.
Yes.
I mean, I feel like they just, like, they're like, just use the same character model for him. But make it look good this time, because, you know, being paid by Captain Crunch or Kellogg's or whoever owns that, I don't know, Quaker?
Yeah, it's Quaker. It's Quaker now. Oh,
okay.
But I just want to say that Jean Lafoot's Cinnamon Crunch, the whole concept of a... mascot who doesn't want to be a mascot. That's really funny to me.
Oh, is that his thing?
Yeah, his slogan was like, you know, for such a bad guy, you make such a great cereal. Well, I didn't mean to.
That is kind of funny. They really, like, I gotta say, cereal mascots are kind of bonkers because they just have so many bizarre character psychoses.
Oh my
god. They're the ones who, like, hate their cereal, and they're the ones who love it, but, like, it's an addiction, so they try to stay away from it, and they're the ones who want it and can't get it, and it's like, god.
And then they're the ones who are their cereal and are constantly eating each other.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, like those cinnamon things now.
Yeah.
My favorite cereal mascot is Poppy the Porcupine.
I love her.
The old, she's awesome, but I also think it's funny because she would just walk around with a suitcase, and anytime she showed up somewhere, people would be like, oh, a porcupine! And then she'd like, well, here's Pop's cereal in my suitcase, and that would help people not be racist against porcupines.
Yeah, they're like, I'm sorry, your restroom is over there, ma'am.
I believe also recently I was like, I think she was the only like girl cereal mascot.
Yeah,
as far as I can tell.
Yeah, I was the one who told you that. Woo-hoo!
Oh, yeah, that's right. I'm taking credit for learning this now, but yeah, you're right. You are the one who mentioned that. Poppy is not in this.
I remembered liking her a lot when I was very, very young and then wondering where she went. Because yeah, after that, she was almost immediately supplanted by no Pops.
Yeah, I remember those. She didn't last very long. Pops seems to have a problem with mascots. They just can't, you know. They're now in that other thing where I think they've got that awful little, like, gremlin that runs around and makes a lot of noise.
That's all something. Of them.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Anyway, sorry, getting off topic. They all get on a ship. Oh, shit, no, before we talk about the ship, I want to mention this other thing. They all receive, you know, the thing saying you are cordially invited to, you know, this tropical dream vacation on a ship. It's basically the plot of, like, I don't know, every cozy mystery where everyone, you know, the group of random people get the invitation to, like, a haunted mansion or something. And the part that I find is interesting is Beetle Bailey gets it in a fortune cookie while he and Sarge are eating at a Chinese restaurant. I believe they're on a date. That's my headcanon for this. And Beetle Bailey is like, it says in it, like, your orders are to report to the ship, General Halftrack. And now dispose of this message. And he's like, I don't know how to dispose of it. So he turns to the next table, and he's like, where Lieutenant Flap is eating dinner with General Halftrack, also on a date, I believe, and asks him what he's supposed to do. And Lieutenant Flap is like, you eat it. And Beetle Bailey is like, I've been had, because I think Sarge is eating
it. Yeah, Sarge has made a giant sundae out of Chinese food on top of the message to eat it. And
yeah.
I'm not sure how he'd been had since it was all the food on their own table, but
yeah, it's confusing. But also, I thought it was weird.
Flap at all?
Yeah, that's true. He is kind of a minor character in Beetle Bailey, so it's interesting that he's the one they chose to stick in this for that cameo. I also thought it was weird because Beetle Bailey was all like, "I don't really believe this is an actual order," and it's like General Halftrack, the person whom apparently gave you that order, is literally at the next table. You could ask him.
And he's just standing there, stock still, like a mannequin.
It's like they didn't want to pay the extra 5 cents for the animation. I think I'm just going to say, I think it's really great that in 1972 that Beetle Bailey was able to, you know, have different lifestyles portrayed, you know, in the
army. He and Sarge are pretty inseparable at this point, so.
Yeah. Well, when they arrive at the boat, you know, because Sarge is dropping Beetle off, Beetle is all like, why don't you come on board and hang out till the ship leaves? And it's like, it's really, it's adorable.
Yes.
Beetle doesn't want to say goodbye. I think it's nice. I don't think Sarge beats Beetle up at all either in this one, which is also.
No, he doesn't. I think Beetle just likes it rough, really. But
well, yeah, yeah. I mean, yeah. it's they have a safe word, so it's all good.
Can I mention the part where Popeye jumps out of the bath without any pants on to answer the call to Skipper?
Oh, that's right. Yes. that's a thing. He hires Wimpy, doesn't he, as his crew?
Yeah, he hires Wimpy as his single crew member and invites Olive Oil along, and she shows up in this string bikini that somehow looks just as small as on her as Annabelle from Eek the Cat's string bikini. That was the first thing I thought of.
Annabelle wore it better, though.
Yeah.
That's going to come up more, though, that string bikini. It is going to be a thing in this.
Dagwood shows up. Dagwood answers the thing after typical, I hope I don't run into the mailman again. Oops.
Oh, it's hilarious. High hilarity.
Yes. Yeah. High and low is hilarity.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. They show up and then they, that's apparently a thing in this one. They know each other. Yeah. So that's great. We forgot to mention another character who's in this, actually, because they play no role at all. Tiger is in it.
Tiger?
He's one of those kids. He's like a little kid who wears a baseball cap. He literally does nothing. Yeah, I've seen his comic strip. It's pretty nondescript, and he really does nothing in this special. So, you know, whatever. Oh,
also, when they were naming the comics who have been kidnapped, one of the characters that Kissinger members having been kidnapped is the inimitable Inspector. Who the hell is that?
What? Yeah, I don't know. Was he the guy with the beard?
Maybe. I don't.
Or is he one of the cats and? Or is he a Cats and Jammer character?
Yeah, that's a Cats and Jammer Kids character, I think.
Okay. I don't know then.
I have no idea who the inimitable Inspector is. I mean,
And we also forgot there's like a couple of other characters who they bring in it. One of them named Jeeves.
Jeeves.
I don't know if it's bringing up father, but it's that old timey
Jigs. Yeah, that's bringing up father. Maggie and Jiggs. Okay, so
that's it. All right. So they're in this too. And they all go on the ship, and the ship leaves, and they're at sea, and some wacky stuff happens, I guess.
Yeah, there's a bunch of laughing style jokes where we get to see everyone. Everyone gets a chance to make some wisecrack, and the Cats and Jammer Kids and the Little King are doing their thing that no kid who's watching this has ever heard of.
Yeah.
And then we get the beginning of the push the button, wrong button joke.
Yeah, that's a running gag in this, because the professor tells Brutus to push a button in order to do a thing, but he pushes the button that turns off the lights or, you know, does all these other things, and it's like, oh, yeah, okay.
That's funny, kid. But
But before they get kidnapped... Before they get captured by the professor and his beam, they have a dinner theater event on the ship. And so Wimpy, who is in charge of this, creates a million different kinds of hamburgers, each specifically catered to the likes of different characters on the ship. So, like, Snuffy Smith gets, like, I don't know, Hominy and Grits Burger. A Moonshine Burger, yeah. And, like, Popeye gets, like, a Spinach Burger. And, like, Dagwood gets, like, a burger with, like, a million, like, patties. And, you know, stuff like that.
And Olive Oil gets one the size of a quarter. So that was pretty funny.
Yeah. And, you know, so there's that. And then they're going to do, like, musical entertainment, but Sparkplug eats all the instruments.
Yes, he's got this guitar sticking out of his body, and I was like, oh, that's some pretty bad body horror for this. And then it doesn't go away. It's not a one-shot joke. The horse keeps the outline of the guitar sticking out of his body for the rest of the movie.
Yeah. Oh, it's a good thing that his design is so crude, or else it would be pretty bad.
Yeah, you're right. Ouch.
So somehow he plays the guitar despite having eaten it, and that allows Olive Oil to do her musical number where she sings that she looks really teeny in her bikini.
Dreamy
in her bikini.
Don't I look dreamy in my bikini? Over and over and over again.
That's the only line in this song.
I might add, over and over again.
It's Olive Oil, so you know what she sounds like. It does not sound good, and it's just it's Sparkplug playing a single chord over and over. I guess it's for humorous purposes, but.
And then the Cats and Jammer Kids hit Olive with a telescope that encompasses her body entirely, and it gets into a whole new realm of body horror.
Oh my god, this is a laugh desert, is what this entire special is. Brutus and the professor are watching this through their, you know, their machine that lets them see everything.
Yeah.
And Brutus is extremely thirsty for Olive Oil because, of course, he is. That's his thing.
Yes.
That's his single defining character trait.
Since he can't be a sailor like Bluto, he can only be horny for Olive.
Hello?
Hello?
Oh, sorry, you cut out there for a second.
Oh, I said, since he's not allowed to be a sailor like Bluto, he could only be horny for Olive.
yeah, that's it. I think, in fact, Brutus isn't even, like, mad at Popeye in this one. He doesn't even really care that much.
No.
Which is, again, he's even got less,
Actually, Popeye gets mad at him more than anything else, but I think he has reason
to
be.
Yeah. So anyway, they all get captured. They get captured. They get put in a dungeon. And then the defenders of the Earth fly over in a plane because they've apparently been dispatched to rescue them before they've been captured. I guess the timing on this is very confusing.
Also, every time we zoom in on the superheroes, it is so Clutch Cargo.
Oh my God. Yeah, it is. I actually half the time thought it was. I thought they just superposed. Because, oh, wow. Okay, so most of the funny comic strip characters, I mean, they aren't well animated, but they're recognizable. These serious ones, they look like garbage.
These animators just cannot draw real people in any respect. When they try to turn their heads, their eyes float around on the surfaces of their faces. like food vacuoles in an amoeba.
They look like, you know, when you're like when you're bored in class and like a little kid is just doodling like strong superhero shit. Like that's what they look like. They're so bad. And the way they move, they don't like move. They just kind of teleport around.
They do as much as this whole special. They do as much moving off screen as possible.
Yeah. I kind of like zoned out on a lot of their stuff. So I think they kind of, they also somehow get on the island.
Yeah. They get on the island and then while they're flying toward the island, Professor Morbid Q Hates Left, Morbid Grimsley. Yeah. He creates a hologram of his own face going bleh at them. And they zoom to avoid it, and they go, "That was the ugliest thing I ever saw. What was it?" And it doesn't go anywhere. None of this goes anywhere. No joke lands. Stop making jokes.
Well, you know, that's the thing. They were like, we're going to have lots of setups with no punchlines, because the comics are in jail, so.
I don't think they could not have been thinking that far ahead.
No, that'd be way too meta for this. they do a thing where like the Mandrake does like says, "Oh, it's all an illusion. It's not real." And then they land on the island and they see some First I think they encounter lava?
Yeah.
Is the lava the first thing you see?
Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. All I know is that they all there's always a convenient trap door just underneath you in this special.
Yeah.
Animators love trap doors because it means you get to draw less and less of the character with each frame.
Yeah. I mean, it's easy. You just take the cell and just kind of jiggle it down a little bit instead of actually drawing anything. So they do some trap doors. They cross a lava pit. They have a cougar, not a cougar, like some sort of big cat appear.
Yeah, some sort of big cat appears, and the Phantom, who was not with the party but just joins them of his own accord, the Phantom shows up and he fights it, and when he's fighting it, he says, "Back, devil."
Yeah, and also, like, when he's fighting it, did you notice, like, they literally just give up on animating?
Yes.
They do the thing where, like, he just teleports. He literally, like, it isn't just like, oh, it's really bad. He does literally teleport around. And I think, like, they fall down a cliff, but, like, they don't move. It's just static shots of them or something. It's like, all right. Well, it's like,
it's the next step up from Reading Rainbow.
Yeah. So they're doing all. And then the Phantom is all like, oh, by the way, this is a dormant volcano we're on. The person who lives here might not know it. Okay, so
one of the jokes that almost landed was when there's a big earthquake because the volcano is about to erupt, and Professor Grimsby goes, "I need to call the landlord about that." And if they'd just gone on, that would be funny. But then he says, wait a minute, I'm the landlord. It's like,
great. Yeah.
You know, sometimes actually, they cushion their way too far out of a joke.
Yeah, yeah. You know, it's like, don't explain the joke. You know, have faith in your material. I forgot, though, there's one thing in this that actually did make me laugh. And it's near the beginning when the professor is using his machine to spy on the comics as they're, like, going about their daily lives.
Oh, yes, his evil computer, he calls it.
Yeah, his evil computer. You know, as the kind you buy down at, I guess, Babbage's at the time.
Evil Babbage's.
Yeah, you get it at, you know, the evil electronics boutique. but he sees, like, Dagwood do, I think, walking to the mailman or whatever, do his Dagwood thing, and he's just like, not funny. And I was like, that's right! It's not funny! Thank you for saying it. We were all thinking it. But anyway, back to the current part where all the comics characters are in jail. Little Iodine and Quincy decide that they are going to send Snuffy Smith's jug through the window with a makeshift slingshot using Jig's suspenders.
Yes, yeah, so
and
congratulations, Jig's. You're part of the storyline, or at least your outfit is.
Yeah, that's his sole contribution to anything in this. So Jig's, they shoot his jug through the window, but Snuffy Smith doesn't want them, so he grabs it, and he flies out the window, and he, like, what, hits a clothesline or something?
Yeah, he hits back? The clothesline where Brutus is doing the laundry, and gets flung right back.
Yeah. So that really didn't go anywhere either. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there you go. Anyway, and then the evil Professor Grimsley is like, I will talk to them on my evil computer let them know that they're going to be here forever. And he does. He's like, you're trapped here. And the comic strip characters tell him, well, actually, laughing is good. So how about we make a little wager, Professor Grimsley? Oh, no laughing.
This is the one thing that really made me laugh was when, you know, they're trying to say, well, why don't you try laughing and or something like that? And he says something like, well, what makes laughing so much better than being miserable? And Olive Oil goes, she actually has to think about it for a second.
Well, you know, he's got a very good point.
Yeah. Oh, we didn't mention the cool claw tanks. I liked those.
Oh, yeah, those. I forgot all about them. What? They were just there, I guess, controlling the island. Huh?
Flash Gordon arrives on the island, and there are these really cool toyetic-looking tanks coming at him, and he just jumps out of their way, and two of them collide, and that's the last we see of them. And it's just like, oh, man, I wanted to... Oh, wait, no. No, the first thing he did was he came at the tank and punched it and went, ow! What did you think was going to happen?
He's Flash Gordon. He maybe punches stuff? I don't know what Flash Gordon does.
Flash! Oh! He maybe punches stuff.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, I mainly know Flash Gordon for that movie, so I'm like, he listens to Queen? And that's it? Hangs out with Brian Blessed? I don't know.
And he sticks his hand in things that have, like, a scorpion in them or something.
Oh, yeah, that's right. He sticks his hand in the little thing from Dune.
Yeah. You know? So that's it. Flash Gordon is all about hand injuries.
Yeah. Okay, that makes sense.
Yes.
So the comic strip characters decide that this wager they're going to make with the professor is they're going to bet him that if they can make him laugh, he has to let them all go.
Yes. So they decide to assemble a big comedy show, as they call it, and Popeye gets on stage as the MC, and he does a Ed Sullivan impression, and it seems like such a massive transgression of the character. Popeye doing impressions. I mean, that's like if the Warner Brothers and sister ate spinach and beat up the security guard.
Yeah, it is extremely out of character. It's very weird, and also. Then this show they put on, they just put on a variety show.
Yeah, it's not like, even comedy.
Most of the stuff they do isn't funny.
Here's some dog tricks.
Yeah, it's like, it's not, that's not funny. It's Daisy, I guess, Bumstead's dog.
Yeah.
Tricks with little Iodine. And then they have Sarge and Otto, but Sarge is doing the tricks and Otto is telling him what to do. Which, yeah, I guess maybe that reversal might be supposed to be funny. I mean, you know.
It has the semblance of a joke.
Yeah, it's joke-like material, yes. But it's not, you know, but there's no, you know, you're just kind of like, huh, okay.
You know what I've heard that called? Mick comedy.
Oh, really?
Yes.
That's a good way to describe it.
Yes, when it has the same relationship to comedy as a Chicken McNugget does to food.
Yeah, yeah. It's something that, like, you look at it and you're like, on a molecular level, it shares, you know, the building blocks of comedy, but they're not put together in any way that is at all coherent. At best, I would say it's Dada absurdism.
Yes, yes. That's very much what this feels like. You know, the man who hated laughter. Go on.
Oh, sorry, no. But then the next one they bring in is Little Iodine and Quincy are going to do a song. Which again is not comedy.
Yes.
So I don't know what's up with that.
And they didn't actually practice for it, so they're forced to just improvise something on stage.
Yeah, and Olive Oil is really pushy.
Olive Oil is a horrible stage mom.
Yeah. She's just like, oh, just go on and just, like, you know, just dance around.
Come on,
and, like,
just
sing.
You know, just wallow around. We don't know anything. Hey, sing about how great you look in your bikini.
Yeah. they do the comic strip rag, which
doesn't actually exist, but they do it anyway.
No, I mean, Quincy does a little dance and I think he kind of does his suspender snapping thingy. Again, I do not. Okay, I'm going to look up Quincy. I got to know who Quincy is now.
Who is Quincy? I thought he was like a medical examiner, but
oh, yeah, I remember that Quincy. When I first saw Quincy in this, I just assumed he was someone from Wii Pals, but
yeah, me too, but because, I don't know about you, but that was, when I was growing up, the only place you saw people of color on the comics page.
Yeah, pretty much. Let's see. Quincy, an American syndicated comic strip published from 1970 to 1986.
Oh, so it was already dead by the time we could read.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Wow. Okay, so it's about an African-American boy being raised by his grandmother in Harlem, one of the earliest Main Street comic strips starring an African-American in a lead role, following Dateline Danger and Luther, another predecessor Wee Pals features an African-American among an ensemble cast. Mm. Okay.
So half of this is about Luther.
Yeah.
Shows you how much there is to say about Quincy.
Yeah. Yeah, Quincy didn't last that long. That's like 16 years. I guess that's a pretty good run.
Yeah, that's almost one and a half times as long as Calvin and Hobbes. Hey.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I'll give him that. Let's see. Cartoonist, historian Bill Crouch wrote that Shearer used Quincy to be ever optimistic and upbeat, with a sunny outlook and a white best friend who was a parody of the cliche, some of my best friends are black. Quincy was blessed with artwork of strong design and creative use of zip tone. Visually, it jumped off the page and at the reader during 16 years, along with Maury Turner's Wee Pals and Luther, it paved the way for current generation. I will say this, the art on Wikipedia of Quincy, way better than the art in the special we just saw.
Probably because could it's be actually stated about any of these comic strips, though.
True. That is very true. The Quincy art has a lot of character. It actually reminds me a lot of Jack Davis from Mad Magazine. Mm. To look at some of the character designs here.
I don't think I've ever seen a Quincy comic strip, but the way you're describing it, have you ever seen Gordo? Would you say it was anything like Gordo?
I have not seen Gordo. Let me look up Gordo comic strip. Gordo comic strip. Let's see. Interesting. I have not seen this. Actually, I'd say, yeah, there's a little bit of, there's some, spiritual similarities in the art, I think.
Mm.
Interesting. Oh, that's a little more recent, though.
Yeah.
Huh. Interesting.
Yeah.
It was praised by the Mexican government and the California State Legislature for promotion of international understanding.
Yes.
It introduced many Americans to Mexican culture. Oh, wow.
Also, it's wow. It was kind of hinted in one Baldo strip that his grandmother used to date Gordo.
Oh, huh. Interesting. Oh, wow. Actually, Gordo ran from 1941 to 1985, so he was concurrent with all this. And the artist was born in 1917 and just died in 2008, so wow.
Whoa.
Wow, I've actually never heard or seen this one, so that's probably just, you know, that obviously represents a very large culture gap in my understanding of comics, because this is kind of a big one.
Yes, it's one that it was gone by the time we could read again, but this is one of those times when I really, you know, I get sad over how transitory the comics have been in how they really affect us, and then they're just gone. There's no, I don't know if there's any major Gordo collection or if any place to go and look at it, and it's certainly not being, you know, shown in mass viewing for anyone who wouldn't be looking for it to discover it and fall in love with it. You know, maybe, I wonder if you could have a TV show or anything. Well, you know, that's what we're doing, isn't it?
That's a little bit, you know.
Kind of the noblest purpose of our own podcast is to expose people to comic strips that they might have completely overlooked, even if we are being extremely sarcastic about it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, unfortunately, Gordo seems to be from United Feature Syndicate.
Yeah.
To my knowledge, I don't know, have they done a crossover similar to this one? Is there a King Feature, a United Feature Syndicate thing where everyone wins a prize to go on a vacation on a ship?
Well, let's see. That would be a ship featuring Peanuts, Garfield, Little Abner, Dilbert, Nancy, and Marmaduke. So,
Well, I will say this. When I was 8 years old, I wrote a colossal fan fiction where all my favorite comic strip characters won a prize on a game show to go on a tropical dream vacation together with my own original OCs, because, of course, you know, that's the way it is.
You wrote this when you were eight?
It was like, yeah, well, I wrote it, but meaning it was in my head, and I drew it very badly.
Okay,
you know?
Okay. That's more, you know, what eight-year-olds do, generally, I find.
Yeah. I mean, it was a thing where if people looked at it, they could be like, well, why is, like, Garfield sitting on, like, one of those Far Side, like, islands with a single palm tree, and with a weird, like, kid with like, you know, like hair, you know, lemon yellow hair, and I forget, like, I think Snoopy was on there, and Heathcliff was in on there too, and, you know, there are a couple others, but, like, they just, I forget what the plot was. I think that a volcano erupted on them. It was basically a ripoff of Garfield in Paradise.
That's the best, you know, if you're gonna rip off, that's, I can't think of one that's better to rip off for that purpose.
Yeah. Well, it's a classic. It was one of only two plot lines that I could conceive of when I was 8 years old. Garfield in Paradise and Ghostbusters. Like, everything had to be one of those two. I was like, well, if you either fight ghosts or you go on a tropical dream vacation, there's really no other plot. It was like, you know how, when the classic Greek playwrights were like, well, it's like man versus man versus nature, man versus himself. Those are the three plots, right? I was like, no. Fight goat, man versus ghost, man versus volcano. Those are the two plots. getting a little far afield. Speaking of tropical dream vacations, they're all trapped on this volcanic island doing a variety show. Well, we're getting in the home stretch because they're doing a...
I guess, I wonder if this ever got rerun, and because you kind of did use the same plot.
That's true. I mean, it's pretty similar. But I mean, when you're a kid, I mean, you know.
Yeah.
Well, what are you going to do to bring all your favorite comic strip characters together? You need some excuse to get them in one spot, and putting them on a cruise ship, yeah, that's a pretty good one.
Well, today, every kid has grown up with Dragon Ball Z, and that just means they all get invited to a fighting tournament.
That's true. You can put them all in a... Actually, yeah. So today, if you were to remake this, you would have all your favorite comic strip characters who appear in the newspaper today, meaning most of the same ones that have been in there for 100 years, you know.
And maybe the characters from Sherman's Lagoon and Pearls Before Swine. And...
Oh, yeah, there you go. And so you'd have, like, you know, yeah, so you'd have, like, Pig versus Dilbert in the big, like, arena and, you know, doing the, like, oh, I'm going to make my power level go over 5,000 or whatever it is they do in that meme. And it's like, no, that's too much power, Dilbert. You're going to use too much Dilbert juice to do this. I don't know. Dilbert be shooting Dilberitos at him or something. I don't know what his power is.
Dilbert juice. Yeah, let's go with
Dilbert
that.
Juice. That's what you call. That's what Dilbert uses. That's
no, that's how
call
you call
it.
Him. Dilbert juice. Dilbert juice. Dilbert juice.
Yeah. He'll appear and tell you why women have smaller thinking bones. We'll get into Dilbert when we do our Dilbert episode, because there's a lot about Dilbert.
There is so much to unpack.
His, yeah. Yes. Anyway, so they're all going to do this stupid thing. They're doing their variety show, and in the middle of it, the professor is like, they're not making me laugh. They're making me hungry. And he just leaves to go get food. Yeah, but
reneging on the agreement? If you could be missing something funny. Come on.
What I like, though, is I don't think the characters know, because he's been watching them on a television screen. So they continue the show even though he's not there to watch.
Oh, speaking of food, you may have been wondering why Popeye didn't just pop a can of spinach and punch his way through the volcano and save them. This is because...
That's a good question.
Yes, this is because his spinach all fell into the ocean. He brought a giant supply of it just in case of emergencies, but then the boat literally dematerialized as they were disembarking and all the cargo fell in the sea.
Yeah, that's important because we're setting something... This is the Chekhov's gun to set up the grand finale of this entire special. The professor is getting food, and so they send Quincy and Little Iodine to Tiger to make a sandwich for Dagwood, because I guess Dagwood is hungry, I think.
Yeah, they were really excited about making a giant sandwich for him. So, you know, usually he does it himself, but whatever.
Yeah, so they do the classic Dagwood sandwich, which is just like, you know, the million...
Yeah, they don't stop where he would. They make a Dagwood sandwich that literally reaches the ceiling of a grand ballroom.
Yeah, they make a Dagwood sandwich so tall that God would destroy it and cause all the comics and characters to start speaking different languages so they could never again collaborate on a sandwich of such hubris to defy God's power. That's how tall this sandwich is.
Do you think that God created a sandwich so tall that even he couldn't eat it?
well, you know, God can do anything. Wait, no, what's the right answer to that question? It's a mystery. It's a mystery. That's it. There was an actual answer to that. I forget. It was in.
I don't know what the actual answer is. I always liked the answer that they gave on 1-900-ZWEBLO, which is, yes, he can make a sandwich so big that he can eat it, and yes, he can eat it. He's God. He doesn't have to worry about contradictions like that.
That's true. That's absolutely true, because God magic, it's like house elf magic in Harry Potter. It's the exact same thing.
Wait, is that why there's stuff being miracles and stuff? Somebody gave God a sock?
Yeah. And then he was like, he was, because
God,
you know,
is free.
Yeah, that was the thing, is like someone gave him a sock once and he was like, Jehovah is free now. It was like, and then it was like then he like put on a Hawaiian shirt like at the end of Aladdin and was like, I'm out of here.
Oh,
anyway,
can I just say that I really want Disney to make a movie about what happened when the genie and Merlin went to Bermuda in the 60s together.
Oh, wow. Talk about a tropical dream vacation.
Yeah.
There you go. Oh, man. That would be something.
Yeah. Sorry to get us on the topic of actually good animation.
Yeah. Stop it. You're distracting it. Okay. So they're making a giant sandwich, and the professor gets really mad about this and says that he's going to scare them away by making faces at them. But it just makes them laugh.
So they're making...
Oh, wait. And I forgot.
Yeah. They drop the sandwich and it burrows through the every floor. It goes through like a wiggle in Xanth, and
yeah. and that's how the heroes, they see the sandwich falling, like it's like, you know,
yeah, it through just the goes through floor the, yeah, like practically nipping the tip off of Steve Canyon's nose, and he says, "Now that was a sandwich."
Yeah, and that's how they find out. So they go up, and meanwhile,
we didn't mention Prince Valiant.
Oh, that's right, Prince Valiant. Prince Valiant is in this. I know.
Prince Valiant is in it for all of 2 seconds.
Okay, so I know that everyone at home was like, "Boy, I wonder if there are any more characters that I don't care about that exist."
Yes, there is.
So Brutus sees the heroes coming and decides that he's going to scare them off by putting a bunch of household items all over himself and pretending to be a knight and threatening them. So Mandrake the Magician causes Prince Valiant to appear to stop him. And Brutus immediately is all like kowtowing to Prince Valiant and being like, "Oh, your highness, your majesty." And it's like, oh, okay.
Yeah, he puts on this ridiculous knight in armor costume that he cobbles together from garbage cans. Also, this is the point where I heard Brutus's voice and was like, "Is that fucking Jim Henson doing his voice?"
Was it?
It sounds just like Waldorf, doesn't it?
Oh, but, you know, you're kind of right.
But no, it's not. Every single voice in this special is done by Bob McFadden, the voice of Snarf.
Really?
Yes.
Wow. That's impressive, because honestly, half of these voices I was convinced were done by Mandark from Dexter's Lab.
You heard that too? Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Especially Beetle Bailey in this. But yeah.
Yeah, I didn't hear it in Beetle so much as I heard it in Dagwood, but yeah, I was like,
yeah.
Dexter, I am smarter than you. Yes, my sandwiches are taller.
Yeah. Wait, so did he do all the voices in this? Even like
all
Mondi?
Of them except for Popeye. Popeye was done by his original voice, Jack Mercer.
Oh, wow. Okay. Interesting.
And all the female voices were done by Corinne Orr, whom I can't tell you who she's. Well, she's just been in a whole bunch of stuff, apparently. She seems to be best known for being the voice of Trixie on Speed Racer.
Oh! Another thing with comparable animation, so yeah.
Yes. Also, this is really interesting. She was the voice of Snuggle Bear.
Oh, it's from the commercials.
Yes. That's one that everyone
knows.
Those.
I love those commercials. That was my favorite TV show when I was a kid. I loved the commercials of the bear. I was like, oh, good. I'm glad the bear show's on again. Yeah. But in this one, so the professor, he makes faces at Quincy and Iodine. They show him a mirror, and he starts laughing at himself.
Yes.
And
they made him laugh with his own reflection.
Yeah. And that melts his icy heart, and now he's good. And likes laughter and decides to let them all go, even though technically they did not win the bet because they did not really make him laugh. He made himself laugh.
You know, as dumb as
but the heroes show up
is,
and they're all like, oh,
I kind of feel like that is sort of a good point. Because
yeah.
When was the last time? Think of all the really awful, shitty people that we see day to day on the news. Can you imagine them actually laughing? Can you imagine them laughing at least even half as hard as we do on making this podcast?
No, honestly, no.
Humor has been bred out of these people. And, you know, I don't want to go so far as to suggest eugenics, but...
I know, but yeah, this is...
Bad people can't laugh very well.
Yeah. So I guess that's why why when the professor laughs, it's basically like his Grinch transformation. He's now, his heart grows like five sizes. And now, he's good.
Wants to rescue everybody because the volcano is exploding.
That's right. The volcano is erupting.
So the superheroes' big adventure through the tunnels where they fight giant tanks and everything, it all came to nothing because now the bad guy is good.
Yeah.
Good plot. Really good. Great denouement there, King Feature Syndicate. Yeah.
Well, then they all escape, right? In the professor's submarine?
Yes, his yellow submarine, of course.
Oh, of course. And they almost don't escape because they get wedged in a thing. They get wedged in, like, a rock.
Yes.
And
oh, we didn't.
But that's when Popeye.
One thing I wanted to add before we go. As they're trying to escape, there was a film cut. And I don't know what the setup was for it, but we go straight to Brutus dressed in women's clothes and Popeye pulling off his wig and yelling, "I'm ashamed of you."
Yeah. So from what follows, my gathering of what happened is because then he's dressed up like a little kid. Yeah. I think he's trying to do the whole thing. Women and children first. So I should go first into the escape route. I think that's what was happening.
Yes.
But because of that cut, we forgot to mention, as everyone is piling into submarine, like Steve Canyon says something to Olive Oil, and Olive Oil is like, "Oh, you're so handsome. Oh my God. Oh, we were made to be together." And she's like looping her arms around him, like her spaghetti arms are like circling him like three times. Like she's a fucking like a Junji Ito character. And then it cuts to like Popeye with Brutus in like drag. So I thought for a second, like, oh, is I thought I literally thought for a second, oh, because Olive Oil has left Popeye for Steve Canyon, now Brutus is like, ah, now I'm gonna, it's my chance with Popeye. but that's the thing, because he only knows Popeye with Olive Oil, maybe Brutus thought, well, Popeye obviously is a cishet, so I have to, you know, I'm going to try to appeal to that. I don't know. That's my first. That was my first thought when that happened. And then I was like, oh, okay. And then, oh, wait, no. He's just trying to get in the submarine faster. Okay. All right. It is. Yeah, that cut really made a lot of difference.
Yeah, but can you believe how much funnier just chopping this up at random makes it? No wonder YouTube poops were such a big thing.
I feel like this thing was made for like reaction GIFs because there are so many.
You're right. Yeah. There really were. Almost anything where it zooms in on the superhero faces.
Yeah. I mean, anything with the Phantom is just like amazing. And his floating eyes. Anyway, so then they escape. They get wedged in a thing. Popeye eats some spinach. He saves the day. So, again, the heroes are even at the very end, completely useless. But then they all go, they escape, and the chief invites them all to the White House for a celebratory lunch.
Even the freaking professor is there.
Even the professor, yeah. And Blondie is all like, "I wonder what we're going to get to eat." And the professor's like, "Maybe it'll be a big sandwich."
How clever.
Yeah, because he's next to Dagwood, who likes sandwiches. I do like that whole thing, because just imagine like, you know, this taking place nowadays, and all the comic strip characters being like, you know, brought into like Trump's White House, where he's got a spread of like McDonald's Big Macs and like filet of fishes out, and the professor's like, "Maybe we'll get a sandwich." Oh boy. But actually they're all sitting around waiting for their food, and the chief, he's nowhere to be seen. He's not there. You know, he's snubbing them, and they're like, well, you know, he's probably really busy doing really important, you know, stuff, like, you know, orchestrating the Watergate break-in, or, I don't know, or, you know, making racial slurs while being recorded on his own tape recorder. But in fact, actually, the chief is reading the comics.
Yes, he's got his feet up on the desk, and he's reading the comics and going,
He's doing the Beavis laugh.
He's just barely fake chuckling at the comics, which is
he's reading sensible chuckle comic. So in this world of the man who hated to laugh, since the comic strip characters are real people who exist, does that mean that the comics page is like they just pose and people take their pictures and it just is put in the comic page, or how does it work? Because clearly the comics page still exists. So
yeah, I mean, and is it always a put on? Does Dagwood get a script saying, okay, you need to do these things at home, and our spies will take photos of you with their telephoto lens for the comics page?
That's true, because he is doing comic stuff at his home in the beginning of this, you know.
Yeah.
But now, I like the idea that they're all just actors who just, like, pose, like, they just pose statically for it, like that Mary Worth, student project. And then, like, Dagwood is like, okay, I'm going to eat a big sandwich in this next scene. What's my motivation? I got to get into the right headspace. Yeah.
Mike, did you ever read Who Censored Roger Rabbit?
I have not read that.
I definitely recommend it. It is so different from the movie that it's a completely different experience. But
oh yeah,
yeah.
Oh,
most importantly, it's that they are not animated characters; they're comic strip characters.
Oh really?
Yes.
Huh.
Not only Roger Rabbit has a comic strip of his own. Baby Herman is a friend of his. He doesn't work with them, but. The funny thing is, they never actually explain whether their words are audible or not, but they do speak in literal physical word balloons. And
oh,
yes. And they're actually taking photos of the word balloons as they speak their lines. And there's, you know, street sweeping is a huge business because toons litter the ground with old word balloons.
Oh, wow. That is very different than the movie.
It is so different. And it is... Well, how about spoiler alert, Roger dies.
Hello?
Hello.
Sorry, my thing froze up for no reason. What was the spoiler? Right after you said spoiler alert.
Spoiler alert, Roger dies.
Oh. Roger, did they put him in the dip?
No, there is no dip. He's shot to death.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
I didn't know. But you can't kill a toon.
Yes, you can. Yes, you can.
Do they shoot him with a little cartoon bullet that talks like a cowboy at least?
No, they just shoot it with an actual bullet. And he's shot with a bullet. And one of the only clues to how he died is that his word balloon, which it says has hardened to the texture of a fortune cookie, is still on the ground with him. And it says,
wow.
And it says, it couldn't be you, which is not much of a hint, I know.
Wow. Okay, this does sound very interesting, though. I'm going to have to check this out.
Highly recommended, yeah.
Wow. Okay. Disney took a lot of liberties. I'm surprised. They're usually so much fealty to source material in Disney productions.
Yeah. Roger, Baby Herman, and Jessica are all in it. But
oh, okay.
Yeah.
Hmm. The man who hated laughter.
The man who hated laughter. Again,
any takeaways from this?
Well, for one thing, that's my new appellation online.
You're going to go to the man who hates laughter.
Yes, go to the man who hates laughter.com. Yeah, no more of the hungry reader. Sorry.
it's a good, you know what? I like it. It's good. It suits you. If there's anyone who hates to laugh, it's you, Ethan.
Oh God, laughter. Blech.
Who needs it?
Laughter. Blech. So, okay. Let's wrap this up with a little detail about how this came to be. It was part of something that ABC was doing in 1972 called the ABC Saturday Superstar Movie, which was a sort of movie of the week for kids.
Uh-huh.
It also included features like the Brady Kids on Mysterious Island.
Ooh.
Yogi's Arc Lark, which you might have actually heard of. That's the first one where Yogi and all the other Hanna-Barbera characters go on a flying ship looking for an unpolluted place to live.
Hmm?
And let's see. Nanny and the Professor. I have never heard of this.
Huh. Okay.
It's...
That is a new one to me.
An American sitcom that's kind of playing on the success of Mary Poppins. Oliver and the Artful Dodger. I remember I showed you clips from that one.
That's
the one where the guy does his little dance where he goes, "I mean, rotten, stingy, and cruel." And, oh boy, Lassie and the Spirit of Thunder Mountain. Oh boy, an animated Lassie movie. I mean, what was the appeal of Lassie outside of it's a cute dog?
Yeah, I guess everything had a cartoon in those days.
Mm-hmm. Animated slash... So, well,
so I guess they needed something to fill that content hole.
Yeah. There's... Some of these are familiar characters. Actually, most of these are familiar characters. Oh, here's one that is pretty clearly a kind of a Peanuts knockoff. It's the Red Baron. This animated feature casts the Red Baron as a hero in a world of heroic anthropomorphic dogs and villainous anthropomorphic cats. Hello?
Oh, sorry. Hello? Sorry, you cut out there a little bit.
Sorry.
I'm sorry. So the Red Baron is a hero.
Yes. And he's maybe he's a dog and the bad guys are cats. And who are the bad guys? Are they Americans?
They'd probably be the Royal Air Force, I guess, right? That's very weird. It's like, so I guess enough time had passed since World War One that we were okay with the Huns now. So, yeah. Still a little weird though, but right.
Well, I mean, if you made me choose between Hitler and the Kaiser, I should probably have to pick the Kaiser, but.
Yeah. I mean, he's got a cooler mustache.
Oh, that's for
and,
sure.
Yeah. Also, he had that hat with the point on it, which is pretty badass. He's an amusing guy. You see him marching around, with his feathers on his hat and everything, and you're like, oh, that's pretty funny. It's pretty funny. I suppose he's probably responsible for substantially fewer deaths. Well, depending on how you slice it, I guess some people might blame him for every death in World War One, but he's a more comical character,
Yes. Well, I mean, we did our best to make Hitler out to be a wacky, clownish figure. I guess because we didn't have the whole story on what was going on over there.
Yeah. He's like, it's like when you see Hitler as like a Dr. Seuss punchline, it's like a lot funnier. More so than when you see later on and it's like, oh, yeah, guess that's not so funny. Mm. But anyway, so, they had to fill up that hole for, put some King Features Syndicate in there.
Yes.
I think the main thing we learned is that King Features got all the crap.
Yeah. I mean, what do they do anyway? We saw what they do, but do they have anything good since then? Let me have a look.
Well, let's take a look. Let's close out with a look at King Features Syndicate and what they've got.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Okay. The first thing that makes my jaw drop is that they have founded King Features Animation. And one of the first things that King Features Animation is going to do is the Cuphead show.
What?
Cuphead? Whoa!
They have Cuphead?
That?
Wow.
Holy shit, if Cuphead had been part of this, it would have been so much better. Why couldn't it have been Cuphead meets the man who hates laughter?
Man, yeah, that would also, in a way, would kind of fit, though, considering that, like, Cuphead is, like, an homage to these classic cartoons.
Yeah, to the this cartoons is more that of a... Popeye and so forth came from.
And yeah, they were making, exactly.
Yeah, they even made some Little King cartoons at that time, as I recall.
Okay. So, who else?
Mm-hmm. They do, Baby Blues. That would have been, I don't know. Okay, yeah. What if Daryl and Wanda had been invited on the, well, it probably wouldn't have been much different, would it? Their kids would have joined in the face-making contest.
Yeah. Zoe and...
Yeah, Zoe, Hammy, and Ren, yeah.
Yeah, they could make a giant sandwich. Yeah, they could do that. That'd probably be funny, I guess.
Dennis the Menace? Yeah. Why wasn't Dennis the Menace in this?
Oh, yeah, that's weird, because he was around at that point.
Yes, that's really strange. Huh. Oh, Croc! Oh, yeah. We keep coming back to Croc.
Croc is like a bad, bad penny. God. Well, even then, they were like, they were probably like, hey, well, what else? Should we put Croc in this? No. One wants that. Nobody wants Croc. That is, if you learn nothing else from our podcast, know this truth. Nobody wants Croc. Oh, wow.
Oh, God.
Mallard
Fillmore.
Oh, my. Wow. Okay. Yeah. There's a man who hates laughter.
The duck who hates laughter.
Oh, my God. Yeah, I just imagine it'd be great. Just be like Mallard Fillmore, like drunk steering the ship into a rock. And then like making a series of like angry comics, blaming it all on like the district court judge. Who like was like, you have to spend time in comics prison. Oh, yeah. I'll show you. Oh, God. Wow. Mallard Fillmore. Ugh.
Oh, here's a Mickey Mouse. Gee, I wonder why that wasn't part of this.
Oh, there was a Mickey Mouse comic strip?
It ran, the first the strip ran from January 13th, 1930 until 1995. So,
what?
Yeah.
I'm going to assume that somehow or other Disney had its claws into that, which would have prevented it from being crossover with any non-Disney properties. So,
yes.
Yeah. Okay. So that makes sense.
Oh, Piranha Club. That's the one that you mentioned to me earlier. So.
Oh, yeah. Okay. All right.
That would be interesting. I mean, the Piranha Club at sea. Oh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Makes sense. Oh, shit. Yeah. Okay. That'd be great. So
he could replace Popeye. Shoot.
Yeah, he'd be great. Well, you know, actually, I like that a lot. It's just a mystery aboard a ship, you know, and he's got to they hire him to figure it out. Like, oh, but it's like Cassandra Cat in her sexy scuba gear is like, you know, behind it all, stealing all of Wimpy's hamburgers or whatever, whatever.
Also, nobody notices that there's this anthropomorphic fox with them. Did you notice that everyone else was human on this ship? Except for Otto?
That's true. Though Otto is weird, because even in the world of Beetle Bailey, he's the only anthropomorphic animal, isn't he?
Yeah. And even then, it's kind of unclear whether he really is that smart or if Sarge just has him very well trained to imitate a person.
I always assumed Otto was kind of like Scooby-Doo, where he's like a regular dog, but he can kind of talk with a dog accent and like do human things, and everyone's just like, yeah, that's a normal thing for dogs to do. Normal.
This is how dogs work. Like the book says, how dogs really work.
Yeah. Well, you know, when you think about it, most comic dogs are kind of like that. Because Snoopy's just a regular dog, and yet somehow Charlie Brown expects him to like drive cars and stuff.
Yeah, and when he drives cars but also flirts with girls, he says, why can't I have a dog like everyone else? That just drives, I guess.
Yeah. It's like, well, all right, Charlie Brown. It's like, some people are never happy. All right. So we've established that, there's some decent, I guess there's some all right, like, comics owned by United Features. But these, again, they all sound kind of second string to me.
Yeah. None of them were, let's see. Actually, I just saw that the ones that I just mentioned, they do, in fact, have Sherman's Lagoon. So...
Oh, all right. There you go. Which, again, perfect for a cruise at sea storyline.
Yeah,
a
beach adventure. Yeah, I could have Sherman discovering the spinach and eating it. And then he, like, I don't know, flexes his dorsal fin and it turns into an anvil. And
Actually, I like this idea a lot.
Oh, and then Hawthorne wears the can as a shell, and it becomes his, and he becomes permanently powered up because he's wearing a spinach can.
Actually, yeah, nice. This is way better than anything they did in this special.
It really is. And well, of course, we don't have to animate it and write it and have it go through customs and go through rewrites and have the censors look at it and have the advertisers look at it. And oh God, why does anyone work in television?
Yeah, as long as we're just like making it up on a podcast listened to by 5 people, yeah, it's like it could be anything. Sky's the limit. Man. No, but yeah. So I think we've now we've created a better comic strip special than anything that United Features or possibly King Features, whichever one created this, because I've forgotten already. Did.
Oh, you know who King Features has?
Who?
Kevin and Kel.
Oh, you mean wait? That's the furry comic, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I know that one.
Now that would be an interesting addition to this.
That would be with like what the carnivorous rabbit son or whatever, right? I think.
Yeah.
Wow.
I would be curious what kind of burger Wimpy would serve him.
Yeah, that would add a lot. Oh, interesting. All right, so. Apparently, they missed a whole lot of opportunities in this thing. all right. So that's the man who hated laughter.
That's the man who hated laughter. That's me, ladies and gentlemen, after I saw this.
All right.
I never thought anything would turn me against laughter, but I will deny laughter 3 times before the cock crows.
Not me, I'm still laughing.
Laughter is not permitted here in the doldrums.
Oh. All right. Anyway. I think I'm going to All right. I'm going to stop it.
Why don't you go watch my movie?